again. Good to see you, Art. Good to see you guys. Hey, Sailor, how's it going?
Thank you.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning. Morning.
Please rise and join me in our opening hymn number 379 in the blue hymnal 379.
Thank you.
inspired your servant Luke, the physician, to set forth in the gospel the love and healing power of your Son. Graciously continue in your church this love and power to heal, to the praise and glory of your name. For Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You can be seated as David comes forward to proclaim. Satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion of the earth, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Because he poured out himself to death, he was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors.
Thanks be to God.
Now please praise Psalm 91 by reading and service in unison with me. Because you made it the Lord your refuge and the Most High of your temptation,
there shall be nothing that happens to you. Neither shall you be away from near your God. For he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. They shall rear you in their hands, lest you smash your foot against a stone. You shall tread on a lion and an adder. You shall trample them on lions and the serpent under your feet. Because he found me in love, therefore I will deliver him. I will protect him, because he knows my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I am with him in trouble. I will rescue him and bring him to honor. With all my hope I satisfy him, and he shall be my salvation.
Now, a reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Every high priest chosen from among mortals is put in charge of things pertaining to God on their behalf, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is subject to weakness. And because of this, he
must offer the sacrifice for his own sins, as well as for those of the people. One does not presume to take the sacrament, but takes it only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications, loud cries and tears, to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who believe in him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
James and John, sons of Zebedee, came forward to Jesus and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" They replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom I have been prepared." When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over all. But it is not so among you. Whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant. Whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Gracious God, may the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be always pleasing and acceptable to you, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. It was the weekend of the 4th and the 5th. Christy and I were blessed to have her daughter, my stepdaughter Mackenzie, spend the night. Mackenzie lives up in the Sheboygan area, but needed to stay overnight because she was running in the Lakefront Marathon on the 5th in the morning. She was running the half marathon. And I'm really grateful for Mackenzie because she has found in running a great peace and grounding and security. It's something that she needs. She's a wonderful mom, but she has three littles, 10, 6, and 3, and you need a break every once in a while from all of that. So she appreciates being out for a run and getting away from that. Again, finding some peace and security in that self-care. It was interesting, though, because this particular weekend, on the 4th and the 5th, normally it's the grandkids, her kids, who come over to stay overnight at Oma and Papa Jay's house. This time it was their mom. She wasn't just going out for a run. She was going out and staying overnight and being away from the kids, which is not really the norm in the rhythm of her life. But on Saturday evening when we were sharing dinner together, she was talking again, not just about the peace and security she finds in running, but also the peace and security she was finding with us and being away from the kids. In her words, she said, "It's so nice to not have to be needed right now." And as life would have it comically, a little while later, she received a video call from her 6-year-old son, Teller, on his tablet. He was in the basement of their house, and he said to her, "I have a bloody nose." Now, we looked at him on the tablet and didn't really see any blood, but he needed to call his mom to tell her that he had a bloody nose. And she asked a very understandable question: "Where's your dad?" Now, Tim's a great dad and a great father, but Keller said, "Well, he's upstairs." And Kenzie said, "Well, why are you calling me? Like, you need to go talk to your dad. I'm here by Oma at Papa Jay's house." And that's when his younger brother, Tatum, who's 3, grabbed the tablet and said to Kenzie, "Mama, you come home now." And Kenzie was like, "Oh, heck no." It was way too peaceful by Oma and Papa Jay's. And that's when he realized that the reason they were crying at her security, the security she found in time away, and even in the run she was looking forward to, was all because Teller and Tatum just needed their mom for a little bit. And Kenzie lovingly gave into that and had a beautiful conversation with them, kind of talking them down from the nosebleed, which we're not really sure ever really happened, and then getting them to go upstairs and see their dad and have Tim help them. Phone call ended, and he joked about Kenzie being needed once again. And about 10 minutes later, phone rings again, and it's Tyler. This time, Dad has come to the rescue because he has a lot of toilet paper shoved up his right nostril, and he's all happy. The nosebleed has been solved and fixed, and they were just calling to tell Kenzie good night and that they loved her. And once again, she responded in kind. I watched this all played out in marvel, both at my gratitude that Kenzie's found some peace and security in running, and even peace and security at our home in the midst of all of that, but also how she allowed love to pry at that security in those two video calls and opened her heart to it as a wonderful mother. I know as much as she enjoyed the peace away, she enjoyed those two video calls with her kids as well. And it wasn't just Kenzie who experienced that with her littles, love's ability to pry at the secure edges of our lives. I know that Christy and Kenzie experienced that too, because they were able to experience some of the security of life pried open as they had some really beautiful and wonderful and vulnerable conversations, lengthy ones, the kind an adult parent can have with an adult child, precisely because there aren't kids tugging at you all the time. I kind of felt left out in the midst of all that, so I went downstairs in the basement and faked a nosebleed and called Christy, and all she did was throw a roll of toilet paper down the steps there. So that's how I got treated. Now that part was a little embellished. But it was a beautiful weekend to see the way in which love can pry at the secure edges of our lives. Because with honest reflection, we work hard to try to maintain security. There's the obvious things we look to for that. Wealth and portfolios that are well diversified and possessions. Maybe it's power and prestige in a place of work. Or maybe it's just in our attempt to really put a lot of effort into trying to control our lives, or if we're honest, trying to control the lives of others around us. The disciples who were closest to Jesus were no different. In today's gospel, it's James and John trying to secure the edges of their lives by coming to Jesus and demanding that he grant them to sit at his right and his left so that they could be secured by glory forever. And Jesus responds not by giving into that, but by prying away at that security that they were seeking, reminding them that their knowledge of what they were getting into was nowhere near as secure as they thought. They had no idea the cup they were going to drink or the baptism with which they were going to be baptized, at least not at that moment. That was something they would have to learn and live into. And then Jesus continuing to pry by opening up this whole new path to real and authentic life, how that's found not in amassing or seeking security to be given to us, but precisely by embracing some insecurity. By letting go of our lives in love and service, by giving generously of who we are, walking with one another. And it was through all of that that we learned new depths and new meaning to life. Just as Jesus learned on the cross, as that letter to the Hebrews celebrates, so would those disciples learn the same thing as they would face the insecurity of the cross, each in their own way, and have to live and learn and grow through an embracing of all of that. There are gifts that come to us when we allow God to pry at the secure edges of our lives. When we allow invitation to embrace some insecurity to stir deep within us. I needed that gift as your priest a few Fridays ago, and I found it in my therapists, otherwise known as our wardens here. That David and Beth are often in on Friday mornings. Dave's often here for men's group. Maybeth is here setting hymn boards and doing different things. And I found myself having a conversation with them, and I was leaning into some nervousness, because if you read the email I sent a few days ago, we, like most parishes, are moving into this season in the fall of reflecting on financial stewardship. And it's always a nervy period for clergy like me, because I fully recognize that I'm the biggest part of the budget. And there's nerviness in all of that. And I was looking at money in the hopes that it would bring me and this parish security. Money is good. It helps that happen. It helps make a lot of things happen. But I know the truth is you can never have enough, right? The church can always use more. I want more for the church, for us to keep about this beautiful mission. We're about it selfishly and personally. I have one more so that I can have full-time work. It's part of the nerviness I was living in because I was looking for security when they met and they were able to shift my gaze in a different direction. Not to see so much it as a search for security, but to celebrate all of the energy and the momentum and the accomplishments we've met about in our time together. And they pointed out to me that that's all happened not because we've been trying to seek and hold on to security, but precisely because we've been willing to step out in faith with one another, which is inherently risky and will bring with it an inherent insecurity. And those of you who were here when this church was smaller in 2016 and you made the decision to call me to serve as your priest, you know the hard work you put in and recognizing the crossroads you were at, where there was a decision, do we close the doors and become something else or go someplace else? Or do we keep them open and step out in faith and us again embracing some real insecurity and fragility in the process? And yet you know beautiful energy and momentum and growth that has been unfolding precisely because of that willingness to embrace some security. There are good gifts that come when God cries at those secure edges of our lives. When we allow that invitation to embrace some insecurity to really stir deeply in our hearts. Because it is an invitation that stands at the heart, not just of today's gospel, but at the heart of the gospel. And the gift of it all is that the invitation doesn't come from God, who understands that we cannot create the security we seek. Rather, the invitation comes from a love that was willing to become flesh and embrace that very insecurity, as Jesus did on the cross, bearing our iniquities, crushed for our infirmities, as that letter from Isaiah lifting up the suffering servant reflects upon. And it's because of that, that our insecurity, which we will always live with, try as we might to avoid it or get rid of it, it's our very insecurity then that can be transformed. It's the means through which grace is able to enter and bring about all sorts of stretching, all sorts of growing, all sorts of connection, all sorts of meaning, and so many other wonderful life-giving gifts that come along with it. Amen.
Amen.
Surely ask continued prayers for little Sophia, who's battling leukemia. We Camille, at Mass express for her safety after being the victim of a crime. Cindy C. Wright, please pray for, continue to pray for all those affected by our recent hurricanes, tornadoes, and natural disasters. Penny offers prayers of gratitude for normal potassium levels for Michelle and the other day's blood work. Stephen A. writes, in thanksgiving for three friends diagnosed with breast cancer, for publication, mental, and spiritual discipline. Jane Ann writes, prayers needed for my son who lives in North Carolina and is going through an awful custody battle. He is feeling very hopeless and depressed. Penny K. writes, I would like for you to say a prayer for our friend Joby, who battled pancreatic cancer. Things are rough right now for her, and the cancer is spreading again. Pam A. writes, continued prayers for improved mental and physical health for Julia. Prayers for Jane and Jim as they struggle with medical issues. Dean P. asks prayers for Laura, who continues to suffer from depression and medical issues. Prayers for Lori C., who is at the end stage of breast cancer. She and her family receive the support and resources to keep her comfortable, and for Lori and her family to be comforted during their grief process. Prayers for Paul, who is struggling with AODA issues, employment, and has housing concerns. Prayers of gratitude for Spencer, who has been accepted into graduate school for an MBA. And prayers of thanksgiving for Dean, as he has completed his rehabilitation for his shoulder surgery, and now will be exploring additional resources to help with his spinal sclerosis. Bennett writes, asking prayers for my dad, David, for his health and for test results regarding an illness he has been experiencing for the past few weeks. And Joshua asks prayers for strength to break his habit of sleeping too much. I invite your prayers and petitions either silently or aloud at this time.
Because he's in the hospital again, and I truly ask that they could finally find out exactly what is troubling his body. Although he is cheerful and willing to accept anything that comes, he is asking for your prayers today that he be healed in all ways possible. Thank you.
Here at St. Luke's, we hold up Jesse, who is preparing for baptism. Members of the group here. A deepening of faith and hope and love in his life. Hear our prayers, loving God, as we give a voice to those that remain hidden in the depths of our hearts. Answer them according to your will, because we make them in faith. In the name of your Son, Jesus, Lord and Savior, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We share that peace however we're most comfortable.
Thank you.
That, please take a compostable cup here, and after consuming, place it in a basket on my far left, and you can make your way back to your pew down the far side left. Now walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, offering the sacrifice to God. Our offertory hymn is hymn number 385 of the Lumen.
Thank you. It is right to give them thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, for the wonderful grace and virtue declared in Luke and all your saints, who have been the chosen vessels of your grace and the lights of the world in their generations. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of your name. After supper, he took a cup of wine. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, said, "Drink, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with Luke and all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us be at peace. Alleluia.
Thank you.
Loving God, our God, we ask you to look with favor on your servants as they begin another year of life. Grant that they may continue to grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen their trust in your goodness and nearness all the days of their lives. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Traveling would like a blessing. Yeah. bless and preserve all who travel, especially Anna and Eric. Surround them with your loving care. Protect them from every danger and bring them in safety to the journey to end. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Anybody carrying a weight physically or emotionally or spiritually like to celebrate the sacrament of meekness? Okay. Before our regularly scheduled announcements, I did send out an email a few days ago as we are stepping into our season reflecting on financial stewardship. Today we're going to hear briefly from our senior warden and treasurer Dave just about kind of the financial landscape at St. Luke's, and then in the following 3 Sundays we'll be hearing from various parish members about what St. Luke's means to them. Our theme this year is Walk in Love, and how they've experienced love walking with them, and what leads them to want to contribute to that work here at St. Luke's. So David, come on.
Tell me I was supposed to be brief. So, good morning. This will be available in the parish post, I believe, too. So, if you miss a word or two, like no keys to that, that's okay. So, dear community of St. Luke's, as we enter the final quarter of 2024 and also begin our stewardship, want to update you on our current financial landscape and also discuss the outlook for 2025. Currently, our landscape is something like this. You may recall that at our annual meeting in January, the membership of St. Luke's approved the proposed 2024 budget of $190,500. Through the first 3 quarters of 2024, I'm pleased to report St. Luke's is actually doing better than the budget. Due primarily to the generous support of our members, our operating revenue is about $6,500 better than budget. Combining this with spending of about $7,500 less than expected, at the end of September, we had a year-to-date net operating revenue of $14,000. Of course, that's subject to change as the final quarter hits us. But this is pretty remarkable, especially since this year our diocesan aid was reduced by $5,000 and our diocesan assessment increased by $2,600. 2024, we've taken advantage of higher interest rates to make money work for us and placing cash and CDs in our QuickBooks checking account. We're earning between 4.25% and 5% on our money, bringing us an extra $300 to $400 each month. In addition to our operating budget, we've also been blessed to have generous members whose extra gifts have gone toward the purchase and installation of a new organ, a new furnace and air conditioner just this past week at a rectory, and a new solar energy system, hopefully yet to be installed this year. Thank you, Wheat Energies, for your all these capital projects will be completed without taking on any debt. So what does it look like in the future? As we begin the budgeting process for 2025, my favorite time of the year, we will again be faced with some very real challenges. For a parish of our size, we are blessed to have a full-time priest in Father Jason. He is the most expensive part of our budget. He's also one of our most valuable assets. We need to remember that. But if we were not receiving aid from the diocese, $30,000 in 2024, and or if we had to provide health insurance for Jason and Christy, Christy gets insurance for both of them through her work, that would run about $30,000 per year in premiums. It would be very difficult to continue to afford a full-time priest. Even without providing health insurance, our total personnel-related costs for our priest employees, including salaries, pension payments, life insurance expenses and payroll taxes account for about 53% of our budgeted expenses. Remember, we have no other paid staff, administrative, maintenance, and other duties apart from the volunteers. Now, the diocese has already informed us that in 2025, our aid will be further reduced by another $5,000 to $25,000 annually. Remember, we are a redevelopment parish, and we've been receiving significant financial aid, $35,000 annually prior to the current year, ever since Father Jason was called to this parish. However, the goal has always been for St. Luke's to be self-sustaining. With the reunification of three historic dioceses in Wisconsin, how much longer we will receive aid is questionable. Only parishes in the former Milwaukee diocese were receiving aid. The serving parishes in the Fond du Lac and Eau Claire diocese received no aid. We recently signed a new 2-year lease with Nestling House, the daycare. Our rental income is an important piece of financial stability, accounting for about 17% of our annual revenue. While it's great to have Nestling House committed to partner with St. Luke's for 2 years, the pandemic taught us all too well that when our former tenant closed his business, the businesses are fragile and can fail. Our church electric bills are expected to go down by about $3,500 annually with the advent of our solar power system, assuming it gets put into place. This year. We have just replaced the rectory furnace and air conditioner units with new, more efficient units. However, even though this will save some energy costs in the rectory, the savings will only marginally help. They weren't all that highly given. The expected increased rates from E Energies, thanks again, mitigate some of those savings. Pledged contributions now account for about 57% of our total revenue. Rental income from the daycare, about 17%. And diocesan aid, about 16%, are the other major sources. But those amounts will be stable or declining going forward. Other sources of revenue include memorials, plate offerings for guests, and so forth, and miscellaneous, which includes interest from the checking accounts, and dividends from our endowment fund contribute about 4%. By the way, I have a note here. If anyone has an extra million or two they'd like to give to our endowment fund, our financial future would be secure. So just keep that in mind. Some numbers now. In 2024, we had 42 family units make pledges, and we had an additional 19 people or family units who didn't formally pledge, but who made contributions for a total of 61 contributors. But the reality of the folks who contribute is much more complex. We have a handful of very generous contributors who account for nearly 40% of our budgeted pledge total. The loss of any one of them would put a significant strain on our ability to operate. While we have worked diligently to become more efficient and reduce costs, in order to become sustainable, parish long term, we do need to increase our pledge revenue. Do this by two ways, attracting more pledging members and by asking our current members to consider increasing their offerings. While it would be great to get $1 million check for the endowment fund today, or to sign up at least 15 new pledging family units today, that's not the reality. But continuing to attract new people to St. Luke's is important. As we build our community by sharing our faith and good works with others. In the meantime, let's listen over the next few weeks as people share how they've experienced love walking with them at St. Luke's and why they give to support our mission and ministry of walking with one another in our community. then let the Spirit guide you. Thanks to all of you for your support of St. Luke's. As always, if you have any questions or comments, please reach out to me in person. I'll be the guy with all the cake on his plate at coffee hour. Via email or phone or text, my numbers and email address are in the written copy. So again, thank you.
And we really are blessed here. As a priest who served in various parishes for many years, when I was talking to my therapists a few weeks ago, Yvette and Dave, and thinking about the vestry here too, we have phenomenal leadership here at St. Luke's. The trust we have as a vestry is amazing. We can have hard conversations. We can even stumble through things together at times, which actually is a sign of health and trust. I don't know if I've ever had that in my priesthood before. So I'm so grateful for the umbrella of really faithful leadership here at St. Luke's. Again, the following weeks, you're going to be hearing from some parish members briefly at the end of each liturgy. And then in the middle of that time, you'll be receiving in the mail. Most of the communications are going out via email, just since it saves money. But you will be receiving in the mail a letter from our stewardship team, along with a pledge card for 2025. There'll be opportunities to pledge online as well. We have an online pledge card. And again, if you have any questions, the only two people who see pledges here at St. Luke's are Dave and myself, so you're welcome to talk to me too if you have questions about our stewardship or your pledge or anything like that. You can see me as well, so thank you for that. Run through announcements really quick. Again, really awesome to announce, some of you heard this last Sunday, that we did receive another $8,000 grant from Faith in Place for our solar project, which means the total amount of parish funds that are committed to this project in the end, when all is said and done, is less than $5,000, which is just amazing. But we are experiencing lots of green from wind energy, so please pray for us and them as we try to move forward, because the solar companies ready to go and start installing, but there's always seem to be a few more eyes to dot and T's to cross. If you're able to come next Saturday to our Halloween party, please do, 5 to 8 here in Bayview. If you can come a little early and help set up or stay a little late and help clean up, that'd be great. We'll be serving free hot cocoa, tons of candy. Thanks to all of you who donated. You can bring candy that day too. There'll be food in the courtyard for parish members and a bonfire. You can hang out there. Also that day, I was able to have one who was getting ready to leave for his first call. He was called as a priest in charge at the Church of the Transfiguration in the Diocese of Chicago. This is a wonderful opportunity for him, but he starts on November 1st there and will be moving down to Chicago with Elizabeth and Odie, their dog, this coming Saturday. They're going to have boxes packed, but we're looking for some help to load their moving truck. That's going to be at about 10:30 a.m. on Saturday. There's a link to Hunter's email in the parish post. Thanks to those who have brought in coats and winter clothing already for the kids at St. Joe's. Keep those coming in if you're able. New or gently used, if you have kids or grandkids who have outgrown them, they will go to good use to help kids in need right here in Milwaukee. Also, a reminder that we're having a Women's Wellness Sip and Paint on November 9th from 1 to 3 p.m. There is a cost of $35 a person for that, and there are 20 spaces available. Maybe Beth is actually traveling this weekend, but there is a link to her email in the Parish Post if you would like to register for that or come to that or have a question. The last thing is, starting next week, it'll be up, but those of you who are a longer time members know we have a custom here at St. Luke's. November begins with the Feast of All Saints, and then November 2nd is the celebration of the commemoration of the faithful departed, or All Souls Day. So throughout the entire month of November, we will have a table of remembrance right over here with a candle and an icon of Christ the Light. You're welcome to bring pictures of family members or friends who have died that you would like to have with you. We'll keep them on the table or altar of remembrance all month long, all November long. There'll also be a book of remembrance, so if you'd like to sign some names of people, we'll hold them in our prayers as well throughout the month of November. So you'll be seeing that starting next Sunday, and again, even starting next Sunday, if you want to bring a photo of a family member or a friend lost and grieve, please do that. And lastly, please come down to coffee hour. One super exciting announcement. Jim, who's sitting up here in the front, works at a golf course, and they did a big Halloween celebration where they had pumpkins for kids, and they had a bunch of leftovers. Jim has about 20 pumpkins in the back of his pickup truck. So if any kids want a free pumpkin to take home today, let the kids have first dibs. And then after that, grown-ups can take one too if you'd like to take a pumpkin to celebrate Halloween. So thank you, Jim. He'll be the one also with some cake on his plate. If you want to talk to him. But we'll organize that during pop. Please rise for your blessing. May the peace that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you all and remain with you forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is 616.